Basically, I'm of the opinion that the market will stay quite suppressed, that we won't see probably anything more than about 7.5 billion in lending last year. At the peak of the market in 2006, there was about 40 billion in lending. So you can see that where we are this year, and it's not likely to go beyond 6 this year, that it's down about 85% in terms of the amount of money being lent. And you do have property prices that have fallen quite spectacularly, and you do have fewer people buying. So that will all lead into it. But I think an 85% reduction in the amount of credit that is going out into the market is not necessarily a positive thing. And for that reason, unless we're going to just stay on a downward trajectory, I think it needs to start going up a little bit more. The one thing that will hold back the residential mortgage market is confidence. People are feeling that if they hold out for another 2 or 3 months that they can get the place for less. And so far, that has been a good decision because it works. Every time they hold out, they end up getting a better price for that property. So the property market hasn't reached a bottom, in my opinion. Having said that, I think that the interest rate market has hit the bottom, that we're not going to see rates getting progressively lower or staying where they are. I think that they're going to start to go up. And because of that, the price of a property versus the cost of a property will remain out of joint with each other. And just to give an idea, you know, if you have a property that was €400,000 on a 2% tracker and it was costing, say, €1,400 a month, a €300,000 on a 4% variable will cost you €1,400 a month. Even though the price of those two properties is very different, the interest rate that is securing that is just, it makes a big difference. That's not to say that you should go and buy property. What it is to say is that if you are buying anyway, you know, get yourself a long-term fixed rate. And if you're happy renting, I would say get yourself a long-term renting contract, because I don't think that rents will continue to keep going down. And if you can fix in a price on rent, which you can do, you just have to say to your landlord, many of them will be happy to sign you up for 5 years. Regarding variable rates, I'm pretty sure that variable rates will go up again in the first quarter of next year. A lot of the banks said in 2010, during the sort of July and August period when they all independently did these rate hikes, that they wouldn't do anything for the rest of the year. And I think that's probably what the intention is. It's a little late now anyway to jump in pre-Christmas and do something. But the gates are open from January on, and they'll probably hold out post-January. I'd say you might see it in February, perhaps late March. But again, in the first quarter, I think there will be interest rate raises on variable rates. So people who have mortgages already are going to see the amount that they're paying out go up. And new borrowers are going to see the amounts that they're offered also go up. As regards the amount, I'm imagining that it will be about 25 to 50 basis points in the first half of the year, and the same again in the second half of the year. So you're looking at rates going, this has nothing to do with the European Central Bank, it's just the banks going up by about 50 basis points to 100 basis points, which is half or 1% on top of what people are paying at the moment. Suffice to say, generally variable rates being at 4.5 to 5% this time next year is where I see the market going. David still doesn't know what a tracker mortgage is. Regarding D, what my feelings are on ECB rate rises, I think we could have another surprise where there's no rate hikes, or we could see something in the second half of the year. Germany is starting to do quite well. As a matter of fact, I think they had a 4% growth recorded there last week. That doesn't mean that the Eurozone is recovering. At the same time, when the biggest economies are starting to get that kind of growth, it doesn't mean that because Ireland is in the doldrums that they're not going to increase rates. But I think a rate hike in the first half of 2011 may be premature. I don't see it happening because there's such contagion in the Eurozone that it could bring down the center if the periphery starts to fall apart. So a rate hike would make it difficult for everybody in those nations, and when it's difficult for them, it reduces the tax takes, and at the same time, the amount that they're paying if they want to issue new bonds roll over their debt, I should say, rather than necessarily just issue new bonds as well, will also be increasing. So I'm quite uncertain, to be honest. I don't think anything will happen till the second half of the year if it does happen, and I don't think it will be anything impressive. Regarding some of the things that have been said lately, I was hoping Ronan Lyons would be here. He mentioned on Twitter that he would be, but he wrote a post about mortgages perhaps not being what breaks the banks. What I would say is that there's a lot of reason to look at that from a purely financial perspective and say no. Look at the amount that are in arrears, take an assumption on the amount that will be repossessed, make an assumption on what those properties will sell for, and that's your cost. But it just doesn't work that way. For a start, we have 91,000 people in arrears by our estimations. We're higher than the central bank figures and lower than Morgan Kelly's. But Morgan Kelly, I showed him my methodology, he said he thought it was sound, so we're not a million miles away from each other. If unemployment goes to 16%, which is what Ernst & Young had reported yesterday, I'm satisfied to say mortgage arrears will go 112,000 households, 120,000. Bearing in mind that quarter on quarter we've had almost like a straight line 10% every year, or every quarter, of an increase. Now, when you're looking at mortgage arrears, you've also, in terms of the banking system, got a situation where performing loans are also a problem, because your tracker mortgages are not making the bank any money. Their funding costs are going up, the amount that they're paying depositors is going up, the money that they're getting from the bailout fund is 5.8%, and they've got this money lent out at 2%, so that's not going to be sustainable. There's a host of reasons over and beyond this then that you start to get into, which is, for instance, say if the banks have 20,000 properties on their book, they then have an operational cost. So if you can imagine the damage that happened to the banks in the credit sense when we started into the meltdown, imagine what would happen to them in the operational sense if they become huge landlords. They might have to have property management people on blocks of apartments, and those apartments might be making very little money for them, but they have that overhead, that cost, because the banks have not been very quick to address their cost base. NIB, for instance, has gotten rid of 25% of its staff. It's closing half of its branches. That's what should be happening. But Irish banks aren't doing that, and they're certainly not letting people go in any significant numbers. In general, I suppose, if people have questions, if you want to start putting them on the box down, well, depending where you put it on your screen, in mine it's at the bottom left, I'll start to answer those. D asked, do I think there's a chance of going lower than 1%? I don't think so, and it's also an issue that you get to a stage where going any lower doesn't make a difference. You can't go to negative figures. Well, the Swedes tried it briefly, but it's when rates get too low, you get to a point where holding cash is actually preferable to any risk instrument. So you don't actually always want rates at zero. A zero interest rate policy is not necessarily going to fix anything. And you can see from the Japanese experience, they toyed with it and have ultimately ended up nearly staying there perpetually. As regards the bank's residential loans being taken into NAMA, well, anything is possible, and they have spoken about that, but I think it would be a terrible idea. Really, what we have been doing throughout the last 2 or 3 years is taking all of the problems that were created in the banking system, identifying them, quantifying them, and then saying to someone totally unassociated with that, guess what, you're going to pay. If we took, let's just take an example that has nothing to do with banks. Say Joe, who is the host of Irish Debate, me, and Dave Hartree. And Dave owes me a load of money, and so I say, Joe, well, you have to pay me. And he says, well, I've got nothing to do with Dave. Why do I have to pay you anything? That's actually what's happening in the Irish economy. The banks made mistakes. The state goes in and guarantees it, and ultimately people who are totally unconnected are footing the bill for it. And effectively this bailout, it's not really a bailout for us, it's a bailout for Europe generally, because what's happening is the banks that have lent Irish banks money are not going to have to suffer the financial loss that they should be suffering. And in return, we're all going to carry the burden for that. In terms of inflation in the Eurozone, how it might affect us, again, we have to see enough inflation in enough of the Eurozone to cause that. We're currently going through an internal devaluation. In other words, because we can't devalue the currency, we're just cutting everything. Right down as far as social welfare, wages, everything is getting reduced. So if you have inflation in the Eurozone, it's going to be a tricky one, because to a degree it may make us more competitive faster, but it will also make it more likely to see an increase in general ECB rates, and that will instantly crush any gain that we might have had because of the effect it will have on credit, because the people who are indebted this time are not institutions. It is the country, obviously, because of things like the bank guarantee, but it's actually individuals. Households are the ones carrying a lot of the debt this time, so you kind of gain on one hand and then lose with the other. Looking at selling a mortgage book for profit. In order to sell a mortgage book for profit, what you have to do is actually realize the loss. If you've got, say, a mortgage book of 100 million and it's paying 2%, which is what tracker books might be doing at the moment, there's no reason for doing that, because you can get a higher return on a German bond, which is considered much more secure. So what you would have to do is discount down the offering. If you sold it for 50 cents on the euro, now it's paying 4%, and you still have some capital appreciation if you're able to get all of the asset back. In other words, a mortgage-backed security isn't like other bonds where you go through time, you collect your coupon, and then it matures one day. What you have is repayment or prepayment. So even though they put an end date on a mortgage-backed security, technically it doesn't have a fixed end date because people repay at different speeds. But again, I don't think that people necessarily want to go out and buy Irish mortgage-backed securities unless they were heavily discounted. That's the only way that we would attract buyers. And doing that would force that loss to be realized, and therefore banks would get hit quite heavily from doing it. In terms of Ronan's relatively optimistic evaluation of loan books, I would be leaning towards Team Morgan. I have a lot of reasons for that, though. I started to go through some of them there a few minutes ago, but basically there are a lot of things that aren't necessarily being accounted for, and because of that, you can't just look at the number of properties in arrears, you know, assume repossessions, and then assume the cost to the bank of those repossessions, because you've got all these other factors that go with it, which is holding and maintaining the properties, getting them sold, closing costs. You've got a myriad of things which mean that it's not just a straight line example of saying, you know, you've got your price, your loss in the cost of production of selling that property, basically, and then your net profit or net loss. Funding in general for the banks is a big issue, so even performing loans are going to start looking like losers. We saw basically that there's officially a bank run on. It's happening primarily on the commercial side. AIB lost 13 million, Bank of Ireland lost 10 billion, or sorry, 13 billion and 10 billion respectively. And that mostly happened within the last 6 months. I can tell you, going to Nationwide UK over in the IFSC, there's literally a queue to see somebody. They were opening about 25 to 30 accounts a day a month ago, and now they're opening 160 accounts a day. They were taking in about 250,000 a day, now they're taking in closer to 10 million a day. So you have all of these basic funding requirements by banks, and at the same time, the people who are funding them are running away. You'll notice that the bonds that are coming up in various banks are being bought out by the government. That's because there's no other buyers. And depositors on a commercial level and a retail level are all leaving as well. So that causes a huge problem for them. And I don't think that that's going to end anytime soon. In terms of passing debt write-offs to banks, to unemployed people, I don't know. I think that if someone can't pay a debt, it's just that simple. They just can't pay. So you either take the property back, which is the traditional method, and to be honest, what I think is probably the correct method. You know, you just don't get to have that house. You move house and you move to a different house. You rent out a house. Or you write down that debt to something that they can pay. And we're actually not doing either of those things. We're not possessing any properties, and we're also not writing down the debts. So we're in a situation where it is absolutely hit and hope. Kick that can down the road, pray for economic recovery, and in an ideal world, in about 3 years, we'll be in a better place to where things won't be as broken as they are now, and maybe unemployment is better, and hopefully things are improving. That's actually the nub of the solution, is praying for economic recovery. Almost everything else is arbitrary. Sorry, Irish job seeker. All right, well, you can watch the recording back if you want. There's lots of things that have happened as well. Just in general finance, I'd love if people have any question. If you hit me with questions, it's probably the best, so that we can keep it fairly interactive, because I love to talk, but I'll just ramble on otherwise. Some changes in terms of retirement planning. That's an interesting thing that came up in the budget. At the moment, you have a workforce of about 1.9 million people. About 2.2 million people. About 1.9 million are thereabouts, maybe just slightly less than that, are actually working. And then of that, up until now, you only had about a million who are paying tax. That was a big imbalance that this budget was hoping to address. And for that reason, when they talked about it being terrible, it was terrible because for lower paid people, they started to pay tax. For people, general middle class people didn't actually get so hit heavily by this budget. But what they did do is they made it harder to provide for your retirement. The concern I would have there is that at the moment we have 5 people working for every pensioner. By the year 2036, it'll be 2 for every one. So 2 people will be supporting one pensioner. And actually, there was an economist from University College Cork who showed that the weight of state pensions is just going up and up and up, and yet the price of a basket of goods is going down, and therefore it would have made great sense to actually cut those state pensions by a certain amount. Having said that, you know, you've got the grey vote who are heavily mobilised, and instead they went after, you know, basic children allowance type benefits. Kids can't vote, nor can they mobilise very effectively, and a lot of their parents are too busy working to take to the streets and write a million letters to their local TD. So I thought that in that respect it was a bit sneaky. They also made a forced contribution of 5% from approved retirement funds instead of 3%. And that was interesting, because what it does is it takes people who are retired and it forces them to take more money out of their pension, so it creates a tax bill in 2010. And at the moment, as we speak, in life insurance companies, there's a lot of activity because people have to take that money out. They have no choice, or, you know, they're not going to be tax compliant. In terms of being able to pay off your mortgage or make more voluntary contributions, Kieran is asking that. Personally, you know, retirement is something that is coming down the road and that everybody hopefully does. But in terms of having more money today, I would say that if you're making additional voluntary contributions, then you've already got some contribution going in there. I think it's better to be debt-free in general. Like, for a living, I put people in debt, but I know that you're better off to be debt-free. So I would say get rid of your debt as a standard, and then when you have no debt, your overheads will be reduced, you can make more of those contributions, and your day-to-day costs are not as high. I do believe you know, put nuts aside for winter, but don't do it at the expense of starving yourself in the present. Have we any other questions coming in from people? Random questions too, I'll take any of them. Okay, well, maybe I'll just I'll throw an idea out there. Everybody has been saying Law Reform Commission, MABS, that we have to change our debt laws, that that's absolutely vital. And here's an interesting idea. When we change our debt laws, I'm satisfied that if they're changed to a point where people can basically go personally bankrupt without having to wait 12 years, I'd be quite satisfied to say that there'll be a large cohort who will then just stop paying their mortgage or strategically default. Because they'll say, at this point, the trade-off for me actually does make sense. That's something that I don't know. It's not really fully thought about, because everybody focuses on the fact that we need to change our debt laws. But once we do, a lot of people might say, well, yeah, I'll sign up to that, unless they have some kind of restriction that you can't do it, or that it reduces on a sliding rule over time. But if it does, then it won't achieve the very thing that people were hoping to get from it. Kieran Kelly, yeah, basically pay down your mortgage, work it down will be the best way. For Rosalind, I'm not saying purely at the expense of a retirement pension. If I recall correctly, Kieran's question was, should I do this or pay more VCs? I think he means voluntary contributions by that. A voluntary contribution tends to be a contribution over and above whatever you're accumulating at present, along with whatever your employer might be putting in. Because of that, I would say that getting rid of debt is the best thing, and that will put you in a better position to have liquid cash to, you know, make savings now and also avail the savings on a pension. The benefits of a pension used to be that you were rewarded for putting money aside. They're going to be getting rid of that over time. So effectively, they want to only give you 20% tax relief, but maybe charge you 41% when you take it out. From an employer's perspective, there's a disincentive there because you're not getting the PRSI relief, and the health levy also doesn't experience relief from it. So at the moment, there's basically a disincentive to provide for a pension. And I think that with uncertainty in the future, given that debt is one of the biggest wealth killers, that you should try and get rid of your debt as a first, if you have a choice of voluntary contributions or clearing your mortgage. Does our company structure need to be brought in line with competitors, and should our bankruptcy laws quick pick and choose the price of the regulars? Okay, I think that our company structure is fine, in our countries, is it the competitors or companies? Everything in Ireland, I think, is relatively decent working. We're actually not a country that is held down by corruption. Like at the top end of having no corruption, you've got the likes of Sweden. At the low end, in very last place, you've got the likes of Somalia. Ireland's issue tends to be actually what they would call embedded networks. In other words, you have various groups at different points in unassociated organizations who can work together because it's a small country and they all know each other, and they might have relatives. Like if you look at our Taoiseach, our Minister of Finance, our Comrade Hanifin as well, all these different people, they're all, you know, sons, daughters of politicians. It's all quite interwoven. And then in businesses, you've got, you know, similar things. You've got, for instance, the retired boss, Dennis Casey, was quite well known. He was in Permanent TSB. His brothers are, you know, bosses in other financial institutions. The Master of the High Court, his brother is the central bank governor, and vice versa, obviously. So you've got, and I'm not saying that there's anything goes wrong with any of these people. I'm just saying that at quite high levels, you've got embedded networks, which are quite often by family ties, professional ties, schools, and various things. So what we need to do is just change the actual way that we deal with things that go wrong in a rational manner. We need to have something that isn't punitive. At the moment, you'll get crushed for 12 years if you go bankrupt, and that's just absolutely ridiculous. It's a massive massive cloud hanging over your head. And any economy that does well lets people fail and lets them get back up and try again. We haven't done that, so that needs to be changed. But in terms of Ireland, structurally, we have to try and look at the way that influence and power is wielded. And that's kind of a massive job to do, because it's hard to always know who knows who and how do certain things happen. As regards the regulatory system, there's a big push towards more regulation, and I don't think that regulation actually will stop anything from happening in the future. Like, we'll still be busy trying to solve the last financial crisis when the next one hits us, because we don't have a shortage of regulation. That's something that is an absolute myth. What we have is a shortage of enforcement. We have a shortage of fairness as well, because although the banks have been the ones who have predominantly done the most damage, and 95% of complaints are about large life insurance companies and banks, you'll notice that when it comes to financial regulator sanctions, that about 90% of them are against small one-man shows who they can easily sanction and shut down. The larger companies have legal budgets that they can fight these things to the bitter end, and you know the regulator knows this. So it's a funny thing that they kind of pick on the small, and the bigger ones, who are the bigger offenders, actually get away with a lot. Kieran just mentioned more ABCs versus paying off the mortgage. Yeah, I'd stick with what I said earlier then. I would probably look at getting rid of debt. In terms of cost structure, Irish Job Seeker was talking about that. There's various things like individual voluntary agreements that they have in the UK, and that's where you basically sit down around a table with all of your unsecured creditors and you come to an agreement. If you said, listen, because of the way things are, I have 200 a month to spend on my debt, and I'm willing to split that with 50 euro to you, 50 euro to this guy, and, you know, 100 euro to this person. And if 75% of the creditors agree, it becomes binding. I think something like that could be quite beneficial. Although what we're seeing in Ireland is that the people who are going under, it's not just a question of unsecured debt being the problem. We have just huge mortgage debt. And that's where the property bubble has kind of skewed the weight of that, so that it's not, say, for instance, in the USA, we've got, you know, credit card debt, car debt, and mortgage debt. In Ireland, it's quite heavily embedded. It's the mortgage market is where the real mess is occurring. All right. Be any other questions or things that people want to know about? Like I said, I'm willing to talk all day on any financial topic. I don't know if it'll necessarily make sense, but I'll give it a stab. Just to tell you, obviously, what my background is, so that you know what I'm doing here. I'm the operations manager with Irish Mortgage Brokers, and if you're unfortunate enough to have had to listen to me on the radio in the past, then you'll know that I talk about mortgages all the time. My background, actually, though, is in life insurance and IT. When I came back to Ireland, I was working for Dell, and then I went into Irish Life. So I'm a qualified financial advisor. I have a mortgage diploma. I'm currently studying for my ACCA exams, my Chartered Financial Analyst exams. Next week's exam is going to be Islamic finance, which is a type of finance that it's compliant with the rules set out in the Quran, so that there's no riba or interest involved. And I think that's something interesting, because if you approach things like that, if banks approach lending actually with a view to saying we're not going to charge interest and just have it fully one-sided, where, you know, we own the property and if you don't pay, you go bang, where they said we're going to share the risk on this somehow, I think that could be a massive benefit to the world. But you know, Sharia compliant finance is not something that I think we'll gain any ground in Ireland anytime soon, for the simple fact that we're a Christian country, and if we started to look at the tenets of that, I think it would be seen really as you're actually adopting that religion rather than you're adopting the financial practices associated with it. In terms of wage levels, Irish Job Seeker, to bring the wage the minimum wage down. I think like minimum wage, people often talk about it not being a living wage, and to be honest with you, it's not meant to be. It's meant to be something that allows young, unskilled males pretty much into the job market. As well as that, a minimum wage can often set price floors that shouldn't exist. I mean, if you've got someone who's 19 and willing to work for €6 an hour, but minimum wage dictates that a company can only hire 4 people because that's set, it actually excludes people as well. I'd much rather just see something where we have a set of circumstances where there's like a certain minimum living standard where we gauge society based on the weak and say we're going to keep everybody at least at some level. But it doesn't necessarily have to be by setting wage prices or controlling labor prices. That's just, I don't know that that's necessarily the solution. If the government took a 0.5% equity in all vehicles incorporated in Ireland, well, Irish Job Seeker, they actually go one better than that. They take a 12.5% stake in all companies minus any liability via corporation tax. I think to look at it in terms of saying share ownership in companies, it's not really the role of the state. The state is there to raise revenue. It has its own various functions that it needs to look at. And over and beyond that, really, it's probably better off if they just take the money rather than start to get involved with having small stakeholdings in lots of different companies. I also don't think that multinationals would locate here on that basis. Now, in China, for instance, that's exactly what they do. The Chinese recently will say, listen, if you want to locate here, we need to have some of the rights of the intellectual property. You have to let us learn how to do these processes because we're going to replicate them, and in return we give you super cheap labor and it allows you to compete internationally. But I just don't think Ireland is able to give a similar offering. We might be able to do something like that perhaps on things that we're strong in, like software. We might be able to do something like that perhaps in, you know, financial services. I'm not talking about banks, I'm talking about the financial services that we export. Other than that, I just wouldn't have confidence that that's a way forward. Joe, and access to 1.2 billion people. Yes, obviously he's alluding to China's massive population. Something cool though, Ronan Lyons has joined us. And you get to see a bit of a debate kick off now, because I was being asked earlier, Ronan, about my view on banks and why mortgages might be sort of the pillar that really kicks them down the road. And I think everybody here read your post the other day about it. So I'll just go through it really briefly, the reasons why I think that mortgage arrears or the mortgage section of the banks could be a huge problem. For a start, we've got 91,000 in arrears, according to our estimations. The state estimations are slightly lower. Morgan Kelly's are slightly higher. Those arrears are growing at about 10% a quarter. It's safe to say if unemployment goes to 16%, which is what Ernst & Young had thought, then next year it will probably break 120,000 in arrears. You've also got the non-arrear loss-making loans, which are your trackers, which I mentioned earlier. Unlike commercial loans, they price off the ECB instead of the Euribor. And banks, by the way, when it comes to Euribor is basically European Interbank Offered Rate, and it's an index made up of millions of transactions. That means that some people are paying below it and others are paying above it. Irish banks are paying far above it. We're the ones that skew it to the higher end. Our mortgage bonds aren't really experiencing any interest in the market. Generally, people are saying that the various bonds that we have issued, there's weak demand for them and their performance is not quite strong. On the funding side, Irish banks are having to pay more to attract deposit. That puts pressure on their funding generally. You know, if you have a bank that's paying 3.6% on deposit and then charging a lender 3.6% or just 3%, you've got a 0.5% loss there before you look at operational costs. And as I said earlier, operational costs for a bank, if it starts to become a large land and property owner, means keeping the places up to scratch, you know, making sure that they're ready to be sold, and various other issues like that. We were speaking about debt laws. I think if they do change the debt laws, there's a lot of people who are just ready to lined up to say, listen, I'm the kind of person who wants to avail of that. I'm going to jump ship now and stop paying. There's also groups out there who are trying to organize either to protect borrowers, like you've got a group called New Beginning, who are out there trying to do it from a legal perspective. There's also other groups who just want to organize kind of a coalition of the indebted to say, listen, the bank will either work with us in a more positive way, or we're going to default en masse. Now, I don't know that either of those groups have gotten massive traction, but you know they are out there, and these are live people looking for a result. So I think that there's a lot to it that needs to be considered. People are working through their savings. Savings rate is staying quite high, but a poll by the Independent showed that I think 25% of people are using part of their savings to live on, and when that runs out, that's going to be a further problem. And the main risk left in the Irish banks actually is their mortgages, because all the commercial cancer is gone. And so the actual arrears aren't the only portion. You've got the cost of funds. The bailout money, for instance, to banks is over 5%, and yet none of them are charging more than 5% on their mortgages. You've got operation, which means taking care of repossessed properties. The fact that they're not firing staff, that they're keeping unprofitable branches open. You know, when they talk about the AIB bonuses, I actually feel it's kind of a contradiction, because at least the people who should have gotten those bonuses probably made the bank money. What about all the dead weight of branches that are just costing money, and yet those jobs are being kept? So there's a lot more to it than just looking at the number of people in arrears, the amount of negative equity, and then assume a straight line reduction in the profits that might be there. I'm just going to have a quick look at some of the questions coming through. Now, Irish Job Seeker, in terms of identifying people who will strategically default, the banks actually do. Like, Permanent TSB has a really, really interesting system where they look at your account activity to see what your behavior might be. When you say what their bank balance is in regards to their mortgage balance, you see, sometimes people have multiple bank accounts. It's not always as straightforward as that. Is to say that, oh, if your bank account is near zero, then you're going to default. And certainly a strategic defaulter goes from a perfect payment record into absolute zero overnight. So they just have a different profile. I don't know how they do it, but there are groups in the USA who spend a lot of time just focusing on that alone. Thanks, David Hartree, for dropping by. Ronan, I'll take some commentary from you about why you figure all my ideas there were wrong.
Well, I don't disagree with a lot of, like, your main idea is that mortgage arrears are a problem, and I'd agree with that. Mortgage arrears are a problem, but the mortgage loan book is a problem. My point yesterday was that when Morgan Kelly says it's a problem that is so big it'll make the bank recapitalization, the NAMA, look like peanuts, I don't believe that at all. In fact, I would disagree with part of what you said there. You said that the business side of things, there's not as much of an issue there on the business side. It's now what's the nasty surprise left for the banks are the mortgages. I think the nasty surprises left for the banks are a mixture of the mortgages and the small and medium business. I don't think any of the small and medium business loans have really been written down yet on the bank's balance sheets, and I think they will. But in terms of, so really my argument is about scale from a banking perspective. What's a problem for the banks in terms of mortgage arrears? I mean, even to get a problem half the size of the problem we've had over the last 2 or 3 years with corporate property lending, the NAMA loan, but even to get a problem half that size, you would need 200,000 people defaulting with house prices falling from the peak by 75% back to 1992 levels. And while I think there's going to be a huge problem from a social perspective over the next 3, 4, 5 years, in particular when interest rates go up, I think it's going to be a huge issue, and there's going to be a lot of people in a lot of trouble. I don't think from a banking perspective, I don't think we should be going out there as Morgan did. I just disagree with that. I don't think we should be trying to spook markets by saying there's an extra few hundred billion you haven't even thought about. The total mortgage loan book in Ireland is 120 billion. The total assets underlying that are about 300 billion. So when you actually look at the risky ones, it's obviously not as clean cut as that. But it comes down to, I agree with you, it's not linear. It is non-linear how these things go from current arrears into future repossessions. But I just don't see 200,000 people, 200,000 homes being repossessed.
Yeah. Well, I suppose in that respect, the banks don't have the capacity to repossess 200,000 homes. And that gets back to that idea of them not being, you know, again, operationally capable of managing a portfolio that size, which is why they are happy to not repossess properties. But what does happen is that those people then have to be reported into the arrears figures, and the arrears figures are only telling a small portion of the story, because of the 120 billion in loans, about 60% of that, 75% is on a variable rate. So you're looking at, you know, 90 billion being variable, 60% of that is on a tracker. So you got 54 billion, which is likely losing money even if the person pays. So even if, you know, I've a Bank of Scotland tracker of 0.9. Even when I make a payment, Bank of Scotland loses because it can't get money for cheaper than that and keep their doors open. So you got 54 billion that is losing money even when it's making money. And then you've got the 90 billion on variable who are quite often the borrowers who came in the last 3 years as trackers were being phased out. Their rates are being pushed up by the institutions 100 basis points last year and probably 50 to 100 basis points in 2011 again, making it more difficult for them. And then you've got the people who are on fixed rates, and one of the big issues is that people who are on fixed rates can't renegotiate without having penalties added on to their overall debt. So in other words, they're amortizing the break costs, and they're reverting onto variable rates anyway. So I don't know that it would make NAMA look like a child's play, or I can't remember what the actual quote was, but I'm absolutely satisfied that it is a total drain on funding. And when you look at what happens in a bank, they have a capital requirement. So anything that is causing losses in the bank, it doesn't automatically wipe out the shareholders until you get to a point where that shareholder, that piece of shareholder equity is the last piece before you start getting below your minimal capital requirements. So that's what the point is. It's causing a constant erosion. It's constantly undercutting the stability and the reputation of our banks, where even the good loans are bad, and then the variable loans are having reduced payment, and you know it's that kind of thing that just, it's like I said, it's a cancer. I agree, small medium enterprise loans, they're a huge problem too, probably haven't been looked at. And to be fair, you know, the sub 20 million NAMA stuff, a lot of that is absolute junk. When you add all of these things together, you know, we have a banking system that I don't think is going to pull through in anything resembling its present scope, its present size, its present offering. We're going to have to mash some of them together. We're going to have to close a lot of the branches down of various institutions. It can't continue because everything is losing. So in that respect, I think that mortgages will probably be the last thing to go, because people will try to hold on to their home until the bitter end. And I kind of see it as the final pillar rather than the Big Bang Theory, but I certainly I'm just absolutely satisfied mortgages are going to be a hot spot of trouble for the next 2 to 3 years.
Yeah, and I noticed Kieran Kelly asked a question there. Won't there be relief for the banks, or from the banks' point of view, when interest rates inevitably do rise over the next couple of years? You would think they'd be happy about that, but what it'll also do is it will push people who are just getting by on trackers at the moment, it will push them perhaps into arrears. if you've got someone on a 300,000 euro mortgage and it's currently on the 1.5% tracker, their repayment is going to go from something like, you know, 1,000 a month up to something like 1,600 a month if you get up to an ECB rate of about 4%. So how many households are you going to be able to find an extra 600 euro in disposable income, you know, over the course of the next 3, 4, 5 years a month, you know, as taxes are going up? Relief is only for those who can continue to pay. There'll be a lot more who won't be able to pay, so it'll be relief tinged with worry about a lot of the people. So, as I say, I'm not trying to give a clear cut message that everything will be okay in mortgages. I'm just saying, when we're talking about the banks, I think the fact that they've so many trackers has been priced in already. Anyone looking at the banks internationally, the markets will have been saying, well, they've got this much in trackers. So that's not a surprise waiting to happen. And in terms of the surprises waiting to happen, my only point was it's a matter of scale. It's a fraction of the NAMA problem, not a multiple of the NAMA problem.
Yeah, I think that's fair to say that it's not going to be a multiple of it. The just on that point that raising rates will be good for trackers. A bank works on the concept of maturity transformation is what they call it. What it means is they borrow money, they lend it out. Generally, they lend it for much longer than the time that they personally borrow it for, and they're rolling it over in between. What that would mean is that if the ECB raises rates to 2%, the bank don't have a fixed funding cost somewhere down near 1%. Their funding costs will increase as well because the base rate of lending will go up. So what the ECB do doesn't really matter to a degree. What matters is, can they make sure that people continue to pay, and can they get their funding costs down to at least Euribor, which they haven't been able to do, and can they drop their deposit rates, which they haven't been able to do effectively either, because the funding comes from different sources. You've got your deposits, you've got all of your bonds, which we hear a lot about lately, you know, subordinated bonds and senior debt, lower tier debt. The fact is that there's no confidence left, even on quite senior debt, in the banks. So I think the AIB lower tier 2 is trading at about 23 cents on the euro. So there's an absolutely expected write down built in there. Whether that happens or not on the secondary market, that's what people are doing. Imagine this: there's a 45% yield on that. If you felt at all confident that AIB were going to pay for 2 years, you'd nearly have your money back and take the write down, and you'd be doing great. But that's the thing; it's not expected. So what happens on ECB rates is important not to forget. The bank is always working on a cost of funds versus what they've lent it out for. And the problem with trackers is that they give a price promise from now until the point of oblivion when that loan is paid off. The better option for the bank might be to actually offer people cash sums to give up their tracker, or to say reprice your tracker instead of ECB plus one. You know, we'll give you 100 euro for every basis point that you're willing to go up. You know, so you go up 50 basis points, you get 5 grand. You go up 1%, we'll give you 10 grand in cash. I'm not saying that exactly, but something along those lines where there's an incentive to leave your tracker. But I don't know that people would even take that up. Work. Yeah, Kira, you're right. You know, don't give up.
You're dead right, Kira.
Irish job seeker. Irish job seeker, if you're a default waiting to happen, you know, what I would say is you need to take a strong look at your own situation and bear in mind that there's nothing wrong with things not working out when it comes to your mortgage. You have a commitment to either take care of yourself or take care of the bank. And while I'm not saying go ahead and default, if that day comes where you have a choice of provide for you and your family or a financial institution, I don't think you should agonize over that decision one bit. and just work with them positively so that it can do as little damage as possible in that process. But certainly, if people were acting rationally and in their own best interest, we would have actually a lot more defaults than what we're seeing. I think, to be honest with you, it's a sort of an Irish thing that we don't see massive levels of strategic default, again, mixed in with the backward debt laws that we spoke about earlier. Who GT is, but you'll know it's him if he starts hitting you with some heavy-ass statistics.
I think a lot of it is about the stigma associated with being bankrupt in Ireland or having your home repossessed in Ireland. It's a cultural thing. It's a very commonly made point at this stage in Ireland about the difference. I mean, it was one of the NAMA developers has gone over to the UK to declare bankruptcy because he'll be back on his feet in a year. Whereas it could be anything up to 12 years here because he's got $1 billion in debt. And for the moment, you know, you don't see, you know, individual households aren't in the same position to be able to do that. But if it changes, that could change the arithmetic a lot.
I can tell you, actually, I know one or two guys who would have owned like 6, 7, 8 properties. And they were the typical Celtic Tiger Cub, you know, driving nice cars, all this kind of stuff. When things got hard, they just went to Australia. They're in Australia right now. One of them was actually contacted by Primetime because he kept showing up in the Stubbs Gazette. And they were wondering, like, geez, I wonder what the story is with this guy. And they found him on Facebook. But that's the thing. Like, going away is an option. And, you know, I just think that when you weigh it against a life of being smashed, if you have an opportunity elsewhere, I actually don't see why people aren't acting more in their own self-interest. There's nothing wrong with losing. I mean, I'll put it this way. A lot of people watch football. Every week, someone loses. And every week, someone is the winner. And in life, it's the same. You know, people lose, people win. And your general approach should be that you want to do whatever helps you win the most. And if that's the case, then make the decision. And don't regret it or feel bad or like a failure, because it's not. It just means that for now, with that particular aspect of your life, it didn't work out the way that you would hope that it works out. But it certainly doesn't make you a loser. What we've done is, in most cases, is a debt. It's a debt secured by the property that you're living in. If you don't hold on to that, that you're terrible. You're not. It just means you move house. People move house all the time.
And the other thing, GT, which really hasn't, GT made a point. Sorry, work away, Karl. Sorry.
Oh, yeah. If you've got a bankruptcy judgment in Ireland, I can tell you this. It's Well, maybe if you're 30 plus or access to future mortgages is reduced in Ireland, your credit history doesn't follow you around the world. I mean, I can tell you that, you know, anyone who says that to you might have a point in terms of it technically being able to follow you around the world, but in fact, it doesn't. Like, I don't think that if you move to Singapore or something that they're going to say, you know, give us your ICB, they don't. What happens is you go to another country. You apply for a credit card with a massive high rate and a cap of 500 euro or dollars or whatever it is that you're working in. You prove your credit worthiness that way. It's like anywhere, you have to rebuild, you have to restart. You know, if you're going to fail, there's always a rebuilding process. That's all it is. But, you know, Irish banks can't go to Australia and chase you. That's just absolute myth.
The other thing I would say is that what hasn't really caught on in Ireland is the fact that you will financially almost certainly be better off renting and saving, not buying. There's very few ways the maths would cut where buying is better than buying your own home leaves you wealthier at retirement than renting and saving the difference. Maybe if house prices fall a lot more and rents don't, that might skew things into balance a little bit more. But in non-bubble environments, the need to take out a mortgage is actually only not—it's only a preference. It's not a need. no one needs to buy a home. You can rent it, save the difference, and you'll be a lot better off when you retire. That's something that really, really hasn't caught hold in Ireland yet, that culture of separating out your investment strategy and your consumption strategy.
Yeah, well, what I would say to GT, just in regards to that the second comment about an American being here in Ireland and past credit history showing up, when I moved back home from the USA in 2001, my credit history from there never was asked about or inquired about. You've got groups like Experian and companies like that keep credit information. But if it was a case that you arrived over off the boat from America or off the plane from America, you walked in and said, I want an overdraft, a credit card, et cetera, et cetera. Well, then they might say, show me your bank account activity. Or they might say, you know, give me a credit check. Or they might use your name, address, and date of birth off your bank account and get a disclaimer from you. And they might go to Experian just to see what your experience was over there. But if you're looking for, you know, a low-end MBNA card with a credit limit of 500 euro, and even make it secured, give them 500 euro so that there's no risk to them, but you've got, you know, one of their penal starter rates, that will put you on the Irish system, and then over time it goes away. So while you may have one instance of it, I would say generally, having done this myself, your credit history doesn't follow you. Mine wasn't bad, fortunately, but I'm just saying even the good one didn't follow me. They didn't offer me credit because I had a good record in America. So I don't accept that would be universally the case. I think that may be down to the timing, the state of your credit and what you were looking to do when you got here and how soon after arriving here that happened.
Guys, I might have to clock off now. Sorry I was late as well. But certainly looks like a good discussion.
That's okay, Rory. I definitely broke the record. Ronan, I came into one of yours with a minute left to go, I think.
We're on the hour anyway, Carl. Thanks a million. Thanks, Ronan, for logging in. I know there's no worries. Thanks for everyone that attended. We had people going to collect kids and stuff like that as well. It's around that time. So we'll catch you again.